first of all, I'm just going to go through a few slides just to explain more generally what adaptive designs are. And there have been a few definitions provided over the years. The first one by the Pharma Adaptive Design Working Group, which is basically a number of pharmaceutical companies coming together and trying to define what adaptive trials were in order to influence the FDA guidance on adaptive design, which came a little later on. And you can see that the first definition was adaptive design as a trial, is a design that uses accumulating data from an ongoing trial to modify aspects of the study without undermining the validity and integrity of the trial. And FDA added a little bit to this by saying that these designs had to be prospectively planned opportunities to modify the study design. And I mean, some of the things to notice in these definitions, especially the FDA's definition, is that there's no talk about unblinded data versus blinded data. So actually a lot of studies that we've been designing and running over the years that have made use of blinded data to change the trial are actually considered adaptive studies, adaptive designs by FDA and more broadly the industry now. It leads to a little bit of confusion because generally we start thinking adaptive design, it must be something that we haven't done in the past. But even the 3+3 design, which we'll be talking about today, basically is an adaptive design if you think about it. So we're talking about designs that are sort of more relatively recent proposals, in the past decade or so, about how to change an ongoing trial, especially using unblinded data at an interim, or changing aspects of the trial that we haven't traditionally sort of considered changing. And all this while ensuring that we basically do correct statistical inference, that we make good inference out of the data that we collect, and that we are able to convince the broader audience, stakeholders that are out there, that this trial was well-planned, well-run, and even though there was an adaptation, there was no sort of tinkering around with data or results to make it look good, favorable to you, or anything like that. So this is where pre-planning has sort of become a big thing. The FDA wants all the adaptations to be pre-planned, which means that amendments to protocols are not adaptations. This is something that you put ahead of time saying, if I see a certain event condition happen during the trial, I'll change it in a certain way. And this is where simulations start playing a role because there's a lot of uncertainty as to how the trial will actually run, and the only way to sort of figure out what you would do under different situations is to sort of simulate the potential future course of the trial. Okay, so I have a couple slides on just the sort of classifications or sort of an overview of the types of adaptations that people are considering these days. At the top of this slide, there's a box called flexible designs. And the point here is that you have to plan these adaptations. So actually a lot of the statistical methods that are around provide statistically valid answers or results even if you don't plan adaptation, but this is not something that'll sort of pass regulatory muster and will convince the scientific community necessarily, because it'll seem a little bit like hocus pocus. So below that is what you might call adaptive designs as per the FDA's definition, where you pre-plan what you're going to do and then follow through with it. And really there's been a division between what you can do in the learn phase and what you can do in the confirmatory phase. Obviously, there's a lot more freedom to do things in the learn phase, and this is where you can do a lot of adaptive dose response modeling and changing of allocation ratios, some Bayesian modeling. There's a lot more flexibility. The FDA is very open to exploratory adaptive designs. In the confirmatory setting, it's a little bit more constrained. There are some adaptations such as group sequential trials, which you're probably all familiar with, that we've been running for decades now. And there are some examples of sample size re-estimation, dose selection, adaptive dose selection in phase three trials. Especially those two have actually been part of NDA submissions. You can even, some people are talking about population enrichment in an adaptive manner. So the only issue is in confirmatory settings, you have to control type 1 error. You have a little less freedom to use some of the Bayesian methods. And there's a lot more to worry about. But they are totally doable. And I think some people in the audience have actually participated in some of those. And there are, of course, seamless designs. So I think the FDA doesn't really like us using the term seamless, but they're basically combining objectives from what has been traditionally different trials into one trial. So like I mentioned, the adaptive dose selection in phase three, you start with more than two arms and then drop some or select one as you go. And that could be what we used to term phase two, three, but we don't really use that terminology anymore. So these are a little bit more details about these types of designs. We're going to focus on first in human trials today. So really, phase one model-based adaptive designs. There's a lot in commonality actually between these designs and what you could do in terms of adaptive dose ranging in phase two. The adaptive dose ranging tends to happen in non-oncology areas because dose is a bit more of a concern or something to be optimized. But of course, with molecular targeted agents, you might also start thinking about maximizing a clinical utility rather than just going straight for toxicity. And so some of these methods are slowly also making their way into oncology also. The difference, of course, is there's a lot more constraints in phase one oncology trial where you're trying to escalate slowly, whereas usually when you're doing adaptive dose range in phase two, you have a therapeutic window and you can sort of move throughout that dose range a little bit more freely. So in the confirmatory setting, I already mentioned a little bit, but it's really sample size reassessment is probably the biggest thing right now, followed by these adaptive dose selection, seamless phase two, three trials. We're seeing some of those. The biggest one is probably group sequential designs. But followed by sample size reassessment in an unblinded manner, adaptive dose selection, and a lot of interest in population enrichment, but there's a lot of questions about it. And actually, I think there's a bit of a movement to sort of people sort of favoring population enrichment designs happening in phase two. And then once you've sort of figured out what your population is going to be, move into phase three and stick with that. And then there's, of course, a lot of work going on with how to combine these things with companion diagnostics and using biomarkers. So the motivation, we've talked a little bit about it, but this really how to basically use knowledge efficiently, how to get more information for the same amount of investment, so using a similar number of patients. It's difficult to compare some of these things. It's not so simple to say, I have 30 patients here, I have 30 patients there, and you need to run simulations, you need to study it to really see where the improvements come. But there's certainly a lot more information that can be built into a model, and that's where a lot of the efficiency comes in. You can combine objectives, which is not what is done traditionally, and sometimes it leads to faster trials and less expensive trials, but this was a message that was touted a lot about a decade ago, and it's not clear that that's the case. What we found is if you start looking more at a program level, you might gain efficiencies because you might learn more stuff, let's say in phase one, that can be used later. So you might be studying doses that you wouldn't have studied, And if you have to backtrack later on when you're in phase three, you might, or in phase two, you might already have some of that information. You might be able to gain some efficiencies that way. So it is possible to gain on time cost, but it's not automatic. And I don't want you to think that that's, that might be the case. There is usually an increased likelihood of success, or if not, then you know, one of the big things is there are a lot of stopping rules built into these designs so that you just cut your chances, cut your risk early if it looks like it's not going anywhere. Okay, so we're going to start with basically an overview of phase one oncology trials. And as most of you know, there is an ethical requirement in running these trials is we can't run them on large numbers of patients, and we have to be very careful about escalating the doses. There are a number of challenges and requirements, and you can sort of translate some of the challenges, how they translate into requirements in the design. So for example, usually we're talking about untested drugs or combinations, perhaps, like maybe the drugs have been tested on their own, but not as a combination. And you're usually talking about very sick patients. So you know, this has been sort of the standard, is you escalate dose cohorts and you use very small number of patients. So you have very little data to make inferences about which is the best dose. Usually the primary objective historically has been determining the maximum tolerated dose, but you know, the objective could be different. I think there's been a little bit of talk about that in this past couple of days with some of the new agents. Sometimes we're looking for an optimally active but a biological dose. But whether you're looking for an MTD or some kind of marker for efficacy, the point is you'd like to accurately estimate that that quantity as best as possible. And if possible, try to put some kind of certainty around what your estimate is. Of course, safety is first, which is why there's a big concern about overdosing. And that's a major thing you need to build into these designs. And then sort of traditionally, it's been thought that, you know, most responses will occur around the MTD. So 80 to 120% of MTD, which is drives the need for trying to avoid subtherapeutic doses and as well as controlling overdosing. So you want to try to escalate quickly and then not overdose, which is part of the challenge. And then once you sort of figure out the best dose for expansion, then you want to enroll more patients at some acceptable active doses just to study a little bit more the potential activity of the compound. And finally, you know, there's always the imperative of doing this all in timely fashion and as efficiently as possible. So this makes for a very challenging set of requirements for these designs. And you know, most designs in phase one oncology have been 3+3 to date. And I've got a few slides to show you sort of the prevalence of these designs. But this design was originally described by Storer in 1989. It's an example of a broader class of designs called up and down designs. You can sort of generalize the rules a bit more. And they were actually originally introduced by Dixon and Mood in 1948. And just out of curiosity, I guess, for fun, this is another sort of up poll, I guess, where you have to tell us what area of application this was developed for originally, right? So this is a complete guess. I don't know how this poll works. I mean, you can try it, but I probably have to type in. It's not working. Huh? Okay, so any ideas what this paper in 1948 was looking at when it proposed these kind of designs? It was soon after wartime. Sorry? Not infections, no. Sorry? Not aircraft manufacturing, but you're getting closer. It was actually in the area of explosives. And from what I understood, what they would do is they'd drop munitions from a height and just see how many would go off unexpectedly. But you know, one of the things that was very different between that application and the how we use it, that design now, is that it was a highly repeatable, reproducible experiment. Every munition was sort of manufactured to certain standards. And so estimating the properties of you know, the rate of explosions was much easier in that setting, whereas patients are very heterogeneous, especially in phase one. And it's not, you know, that design has been adapted from a very different setting, and it may not be optimal, as many people have actually shown. So there have been a few publications in the past few years sort of looking at how much these designs are used, or more likely, how much are these alternative designs used, because some of these alternative designs, like the continual reassessment method, were proposed 30 years ago now, or 20 years ago, 25 years ago. And you can see that in between 1991 and 2006, about 98% of published phase ones have all been 3+3, so very little uptake on these other methods. Similarly, this other study looked at phase one trials between 2007 and 2008 and found 96% of published phase one trials were using some kind of variation of 3+3. So that seems to be changing, which is you know, part of the reason we're talking about this today, and we can discuss it some more, why people are starting to look at other designs. But this is a bit what the standard 3+3 does. I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. You basically study three patients at a time. Each cohort is three patients. And depending on what you see in terms of dose-limiting toxicities, you either increase or decrease the dose or potentially stay at the same dose. The rules are extremely simple, and that's part of the reason this has been so popular. So you enroll three patients. If you see no DLT, you get to escalate to the next dose. If you see one DLT, you expand the cohort. You add another three patients, basically. If you see one out of six DLTs, you can escalate again. And if you see more than one DLT, either out of three or out of six, you de-escalate. At the point where you de-escalate, if you, you're basically ready to declare an MTD if you've already studied six patients. And at that point, most people sort of do a dose expansion of the cohort to study more patients at that dose. So, you know, that's part of the appeal. It's a very simple algorithm. Anybody can use it. You don't need people like me, statisticians, to help you on this. And that allows you to just quickly get set up and just move along. Now, I wanted to ask you also was, in terms of the property of this design, what you think the property is. So basically, if you get an MTD using a 3+3 design, what do you think the rate of DLTs is that you've actually targeted? Is the MTD representing 33% toxicity, the dose that gives you 33% toxicity? Is it a dose that gives you 30% toxicity? Is it actually somewhere between 16% and 33%? Or has it actually not been formally defined? I don't know what's going on. Oh, now we're using phones? Okay. Okay, so why don't you text your answer to one of these numbers? It's pretty good answers. So actually, it's not formally defined. However, just from people studying how these trials have performed over the years and so on, they found that it's somewhere between 16 and 33%. So it's kind of a blunt instrument. You might get something in between there, but you're not quite sure what. So one of the appeals of these model-based designs is that you can actually target specific probabilities of toxicity. And we'll see that in a bit. But here's some of the limitations of the 3 plus 3. One of them is that it ignores history. You only look at the last three patients that came in. So you can see seeing 0 out of 3 five times in five cohorts and then seeing a 2 out of 6 gives you exactly the same information as if you've seen 0 out of 3 and then followed by a 2 out of 6. So the fact that you didn't see any toxicities leading up to that, you know, that previous cohort is completely ignored. And that just doesn't seem to make sense. You should make use of all that information. There's also an issue of different situations lead to the same action. So if you get 0 out of 3 or 1 out of 6 at a dose, you escalate. And those are not the same outcomes. Similarly, if you see anything more than 1 DLT out of 3 or 6, it all leads to the same action, which is de-escalate. Some of those things just seem to, it seems like we could do a better job of modeling the information that we have. It also ignores uncertainty. So if the true DLT rate is 0.5, this is the unknown DLT rate, then just using basic binomial distribution theory, you'll naturally have 11% of the time see zeros or one DLT in 6 patients. So you're putting yourself, you have a 1 in 10 chance of actually escalating, even though there's 50% toxicity. Similarly, if the true DLT rate is quite low, 0.166, you have more than you have 25% chance, 26% chance of actually de-escalating because you'll see at least 2 DLTs out of 6. So, this is problematic because you're either putting patients at risk or missing a potentially good drug. You can also not re-escalate. If you de-escalate with a 3 plus 3 design, that's it. You're done. You declare an MTD, and that's it. This is not the case with some of these model-based designs. The cohort sizes are fixed. It's usually either 3 or 6. And it becomes problematic. As you know, you might just have patients come in, and you have to enroll them, and suddenly you've got 4 patients in a cohort. And you know, how does the rule apply now? Or you may have very slow enrollment, and so it takes you 3 months to enroll 3 patients. And is there nothing you can do about that? So you're kind of stuck with this cohort size of 3, which sometime you might want flexibility around. You have to predefine dose levels. You can't change them midway. You can a little bit, but you tend to predefine them. And some sort of simulations by statisticians have shown, one, that you have a low probability of selecting the true MTD. The 3 plus 3 tends to underestimate the real MTD. And two, there's high variability. I actually heard stories from one large pharma who in-licensed a program, and the smaller company had run 3 or 4 trials, 3 or 4 different MTDs. So that's typical of doing these types of trials. Sure. So that's another one of the limitations is that, there's been some proposals to get a little bit around that, but DLTs are defined as certain types of toxicities, usually grade 3 and higher. And if you see a lower grade toxicity, you kind of overrule the algorithm, but the algorithm doesn't, you can potentially I mean, the clinician will just say, you know, we'll not escalate this time or whatever. I mean, they might just overrule the rules, but it doesn't get incorporated into the design, really. It's just you're sort of overruling the design, which is a little bit more akin to what we do in phase three, where you've got an interim analysis. It's really based on efficacy, and then safety just trumps efficacy. So that's a little bit that way here. In some of the model-based methods, you can actually take that into account, or it's more built into the method, which is part of the appeal. So you've got a lot more, you can integrate a lot of that information and some other information much more formally, much more easily, and make better decisions. We'll come back to some of that a little later on, I think. The major thing here is that we're basically not taking into account uncertainty. We're assuming that what we observe is true, instead of assuming that what we observe is reflecting some true underlying DLT rate. And this is where the statistical modeling can come in and basically help you try to infer what is actually going on, if you want, behind the scenes, and what it means in terms of your likelihood of toxicity in the next cohort. So a lot of the modeling can help you basically do some prediction and guide you in your decisions. And that word is important. It's the statistics are really a tool to support decision making, to guide it. They're not prescriptive. And too often people sort of think that these algorithms are imposing decisions on them. They really aren't, and they shouldn't be presented that way if they've been presented to you that way in the past. So adaptive modeling basically means that whatever you see, you build into a model of the dose toxicity profile. So there's some assumptions about what the model looks like, but when you incorporate the data as it comes in, you update the model, and based on what the model is telling you in terms of predictions or what the model thinks the MTD is, the variability around that, you make a decision to escalate, de-escalate, dose more patients, you can backfill cohorts, so put patients at lower doses. You can split cohorts, so you can investigate higher doses and at the same time investigate lower doses. There's a lot more flexibility because of the models that are running in the background. So, very often Bayesian and adaptive are often sort of put together, and that's not really automatic. There are many methods that are not Bayesian, that are classical frequentist methods that lead to adaptive designs. Bayesian methods, on the other hand, are sort of naturally adaptive, which is why they're so sort of married in people's minds with adaptive. So they're much more akin to the way we think, which is why they're also much more appealing. And this is an example that's a little bit different. It's in the sort of pathology area. But suppose you saw a little 2x2 table like this, where in the control arm, you saw 0 tumors out of 50, right? They might be rats that you modified some genes on or something, and you want to see what happens. But in the experimental arm, you see 3 tumors out of 50, right? Now, if you do a classical Fisher's exact test, which is a frequentist test, for this table, you'll get a p-value of 0.121. So pathologists will get excited, like 3 tumors, that's biologically significant, that's great. And the statisticians will be like, well, you know, that's not statistically significant, that's noise. Now, how do you reconcile these different views? Well, part of the reason is that the pathologist is probably thinking about all the stuff he's done in the past. Right? A little bit like our example, he's not thinking about only the last cohort of 3 patients or 3 rats. He's thinking about the 450 rats he's been testing in the past year or two or whatever. And he's never seen a tumor in all those rats, and suddenly he's seeing 3 of them. So actually, his table in his mind looks like this. It's, there's a 0 out of 500, and there's a 3 out of 50. And if you actually do the same frequentist Fisher's exact test on this table, you get a very significant p-value. So, you know, what's happened here is you've incorporated information that's external to the trial that you just ran. Here is historical information. That information could come from another trial that you're running, what your prior experience is. Maybe you take five trials that have run. Maybe this was, you know, five separate trials of 100 rats or whatever. But all that gets pooled together and informs, you know, the current experiment. And at its core, that's a little bit what Bayesian thinking is doing, Bayesian framework of statistics. So a little bit more formally, so Bayesian, the Bayesian framework looks at the probability of an underlying parameter, which would be like the DLT rate in this case. So if something, some quantity of interest, you're looking at its distribution, right? Well, what's the possible values it can take? And what happens here is that you take what is called the prior, which would be the 450 rats that you know about historically. So that prior is part of what's needs to be discussed a lot and figured out with clinicians and the rest of the team to figure out how to describe that prior. But that prior can come from publications, from trials that have been run before, from KOLs, experts, context, just general, anything that can inform you at that point, you can put into that prior. And that gets combined with whatever the experimental data is, so the observed data. The observed data tells you something different. And these two get weighted together to get sort of what you might call updated evidence. So the more data you have, the more it'll sort of drown out the historical information. And when you have very little data, it might be more informed by the historical information. And the balancing of those two is part of what you need to do at the beginning of a trial when designing it. The interesting thing also is that since you have a distribution, you can actually make predictions about that distribution. You can make probability statements. So what's the probability that my DLT rate is greater than 60%? That's a statement that you can actually quantify using a Bayesian approach. And that's a lot of, you know, that's also very powerful because it's much more akin to the way people think of the information and how they'd like to have it available. You know, probability of raining tomorrow. Many of the models that you see, you know, weather recommendations on Netflix, Amazon, they're all driven by this type of framework where information accumulates, and as it accumulates, you update the knowledge you have and the predictions you can make about what people will want or what things will look like. Weather is a bit different, actually. But. So importantly, I mentioned, so even though there's, you've got these powerful models, you actually need to, I mean, the way this has worked beautifully, let's say at a company like Novartis, is that it's married with clinical expertise. The statistics are really a decision guiding support tool. So you run these algorithms, the statistician will be at these dose escalation committees, will run the algorithm and say the model suggests that you escalate to this dose. Then there'll be a conversation that brings in a lot more information into the decision, including what are the non-DLT type of adverse events, toxicities, what do the labs look like, how did individual patients do, how long were they on treatment. I mean, all the information that comes basically from clinical judgment, from how the trial is progressing, and all that basically leads to a decision about the dose for the next cohort or the next patient, or you could even decide the size of the next cohort. Maybe you only want to enroll one more patient just to get additional data, or you want to enroll eight more patients. That can be decided at these committees, and the statistics then are just one part of all the information that you have. I mean, the interesting thing, though, is that because you're modeling, if you deviate from what the model recommends, that's okay. The model will just adjust for that. It can, because you're modeling the whole dose response curve, it doesn't matter whether you actually followed the plan. You'll just plug in whatever the dose was and was there a toxicity or not, and that'll just contribute data to the model. So that's also very helpful. Okay, so I'm going to go through, there's been tons and tons of models proposed over the years, each one trying to refine or fix things that didn't work in the previous ones and so on. And I'm going to just go over three. The first one, just because it's been historically proposed, like the first one, and you know, just to go over it. And then the other two, because they're probably the most popular right now, and those are the ones I think we want to sort of expose you to and discuss. So the continual reassessment method you probably have heard about. This was the first sort of model-based methods that was suggested by O'Quigley and his collaborators in 1990. And basically, it does a little bit what we mentioned, but it's a single parameter model. So it only models, it assumes there's one parameter missing. And that means that it's good at identifying the MTD, but it doesn't do a very good job of modeling the whole dose toxicity curve, because there's just not enough there's not enough parameters to sort of describe the whole curve. So it does very well at pinpointing one value of interest. But it does have the advantages of model-based methods, which is it uses all the available information, all the patients that have been in the trial, to guide the next dose assignment. And it does it based on sort of these predictions, these posterior toxicity probabilities. So how likely is it, basically tries to assign the next patient as close to what it thinks the MTD is as possible. Now, this was quickly criticized, which is why there was a slew of papers trying to fix the problems, and mostly because of safety concerns. See, the original MTD, CRM didn't allowed you to start at any dose, not the lowest dose. Cohort sizes, it suggested cohort sizes of one patient. It did not restrict escalation. You could jump doses all around. And so clinicians especially reacted negatively to this because there seemed to be a lot of risk to the patients of overdosing, of and skepticism about the model-based approach at that time. So, I mean, the major criticisms were addressed by Goodman et al. In 95, and the key differences with the original CRM were you start at the lowest dose, sort of follow a 3+3 type of Fibonacci escalation sequence between doses. You don't skip doses if you haven't tested them, and you stick to cohort sizes that people have been sort of historically comfortable with, so 3 to 6. And you know, this loses a little bit of efficiency, but it addresses the issues of safety and toxicity and so on. The Bayesian logistic regression model is a little bit what Onyx is going to describe. This is the model they've used in their designs. It's also the only design that Novartis uses. They've run 150 plus trials, and this is the type of designs they use in phase one oncology. They do combination versions of this and all sorts of versions. The people who've published this are actually Novartis statisticians, so Neuschwander et al. And the main difference is this is a two-parameter logistic model. So they're modeling the whole curve, not just modeling the MTD. They can actually describe the whole dose toxicity curve. And again, it makes use of all the information, but it also recommends doses not just on being close to one target probability, like say 33%, but actually based on the probability of falling into certain intervals. And they define four toxicity intervals. So these limits are dependent on the design, on the trial that you're running. So for example, this might be one example where your targeted toxicity is, say, 30%. And so your interval, which is considered targeted interval of toxicity, might be between 0.2 and 0.35. Anything in that interval is considered good enough, close enough to what you're targeting. Whereas if you're below 20% toxicity, that would be underdosing. And if you go above, that would be overdosing. And what often gets associated with these designs is an overdose control, which basically eliminates any doses that are overly toxic. So if the probability of having an excessive or unacceptable toxicity is greater than 25%, for instance, you may stop visiting that dose. And that dose and anything higher, you might just eliminate and stick to the to whatever doses are below that. So we'll go through a little bit of example of how that works. But this is the difference between these approaches. In general, the applicability of the rule-based method, so rule-based is really 3 plus 3, it's very easy to implement, as we mentioned, because you don't really need SATs. There's an algorithm, you just use it. The model-based methods are more complex, and you sort of need statistical support. If you look at flexibility, the 3 plus 3, the rule-based methods are not flexible. You fix cohort size, fix doses. With models, you can actually change cohort sizes, change doses. You can insert intermediate doses. You can put in doses that were not planned, especially with, if these are injectables and you can just dilute the concentration, then that makes it that much easier. There's also extensibility. If you want to do something a little bit more complex, it's difficult with the 3 plus 3. For example, how do you run a combination toxicity trial? If you really want to study both agents along different doses, there's no real sort of paradigm for doing that with a rule-based method. So this is much more easily incorporated in a modeling framework. In terms of the DLT rates, because you have a model, you can do a lot more inference, a lot more probabilistic statements. You can give a lot more information for people to make decisions about. The statistical requirements, as I mentioned, rule-based are none, but in the model-based approach, you need some good statistics, basically. And the decisions, the rule-based method, really the algorithm decides, and then sometimes the clinician overrules. But the model-based methods are really meant to provide recommendations to the clinical team so that they can make the decision to escalate or not. So let me give you a little bit, some few graphics and stuff to sort of illustrate some of these things. So this is an example from the paper by Neuschwander et al. It's a little bit adapted, but this was a trial that had 15 doses or something like that. 1 through 250, you can see them right there. And it was considered unacceptable to have toxicity, excessive or unacceptable toxicity. There was an overdose control. So if that was greater than 25%, you wouldn't use those doses anymore. And it was decided sometime during protocol review that you wouldn't skip any dose levels during dose escalation, which is okay, makes sense. So the first thing you might do is do some simulations, because you don't really know what the true dose toxicity curve looks like. So you need to figure out how does your design perform under different circumstances. So here are three different dose toxicity curves. And you can see if 30% is really your targeted toxicity, your MTD is different for these different dose toxicity profiles. So this is sort of the unknown, and now you can sort of run some simulations, apply your design, and see how does it perform. Okay. And here you can actually see results. So it's a little bit complicated, but the colors are basically representing those three curves. So you've got the red bars that sort of show you the first curve that had an MTD at 5 milligrams is the MTD. And the red bars are showing you how often was that dose selected as the MTD. So this Bayesian logistic regression picked up dose 5 the most often, right? And then you can see it picked 10 and 2.5 and 15, a little bit roughly about the same. The second dose response curve had an MTD of 30. And you can see that the design, same design, is doing a pretty good job at picking up 30, but it tends to also overestimate. It takes, often goes up to 40. It's selected 40 as the MTD quite often also. And then the last dose response curve had a very high MTD at 100, and you can see that it's picking up the MTD at 75 most of the time. Part of the reason that it's doing that is that these simulations were run with 36 patients, and there's just not enough cohorts to get up to those highest doses, right? So it's, the algorithm just doesn't get all the way up to 100, 150. This is an example, a sample trial. So another use of simulation is to sort of make it come alive in people's minds what might happen. Okay? So it's like a what-if scenario. So this is a possible scenario of what might happen. And you can see, this is for an example in that situation where the MTD was 100, and you can see it it escalated, and then there was a cohort of three where you saw one DLT, that's that blue dot. It was decided based on the model that should stay at that dose. Saw zero out of three. We continued to stay at that dose. Now we saw two DLTs, and we came back down, and we came back up. So there's things here going on that you wouldn't see in a 3+3. A 3+3 would have stopped, it would have escalated, first of all, because it would have seen one out of six and it would have escalated. But it certainly wouldn't have revisited a dose like it did here. So this is sort of showing you what you get in terms of information. So this is basically modeling the dose response curve. And you can see the blue dots are basically showing you the estimate of based on the model of what the DLT rate is at those doses. And you have confidence intervals that sort of show you how confident this is the toxicity rate. And based on that, the red dot is your current most likely MTD. So simulations also allow you to look at things such as average allocation, average toxicity. If you use this design, are you at risk of overdosing? Things that I'm not showing here, but you can model sort of time, how long it'll take, how many patients will be used. So a lot of these things can be modeled so you get an idea. And you can compare designs that way or compare scenarios and sort of figure out what decision you'll be taking. So I guess Novartis, I don't know if this is a fictitious trial or an actual trial, but this trial was run, and they put three patients on dose one. They saw no DLT. They then increased to 2.5 on the next cohort, and they put four patients there. They saw no DLT. I think some of these patients may have dropped out, or they're just reporting number of patients. I'm not sure why the cohort size is changing. They then kept escalating, so they saw no DLTs at 5 milligrams, no DLTs at 10 milligrams, and then for some unknown reason, or reason not explained in this article, they decided to skip two doses. They went straight to 25 milligrams, and they saw two DLTs out of two patients. And question to you guys is, what would you do next? If you saw this, would you de-escalate two doses? Would you de-escalate one dose? Would you stay at that same dose? Or do you have some other proposal? So any, you're gonna run a poll? Okay. Let's see what you might do. So de-escalate to 15 milligrams means drop two doses. De-escalate to 20 milligrams just means drop to the dose below. We're at 25. Stay at 25 is stay at the dose that you were testing. And then if you want to escalate or if you want to drop three doses, just answer D. See, everybody cares about patient safety. So, let's see. Okay, so this is an example of the information that would come out of the model that might make you, you know, might guide your decision. And it's basically showing you, based on the data that we just talked about, what is the probability of, at the top, underdosing. So you see a blue bar for every dose, right? So you generate this probability of underdosing for every dose. So this is telling you, for dose one, the probability of underdosing, meaning that the DLT rate is between 0 and 20%, is basically 100%. And as you go up to higher doses, in part because of the data, in part because they haven't been studied, that underdosing probability drops. In the middle panel, you see the probability of being on target. So right now, dose 15 has the highest probability of being on target, of having between 20% and 35% toxicity probability. And in the bottom panel, you see the probability of overdosing. So what are the doses that look like are just too high in terms of toxicity? And you know, you want that to be below 25%. So starting with dose 20, you actually have doses that are sort of risky. So this plus everything else, all the other data that you get from a clinical trial would inform the decision to escalate. So, you know, how many grade 2 toxicities were there? Were some of these toxicities easily manageable? Or maybe some of them were questionable? Maybe some subjects were not evaluable and were mistakenly put in there? Lab results. So take all that information and make some decision. What happened in this trial was that they dropped one dose. So they went to the 20 milligram, even though, you know, the algorithm, as you can see on the right here in row 5, was recommending dose 15 as being the most, probably the best decision. The team decided, let's go with 20 milligrams. And they studied 9 patients, 2 DLTs, and based on that, they were able to stop the trial and declare 20 as their MTD. And what you can see on the bottom is actually a fit of the dose toxicity curve. So based on all this data, what is the predicted dose toxicity curve? And, you know, what are the intervals of confidence around those? So I just sort of presented you the model-based method. As I mentioned, the BLRM, the Bayesian Logistic Regression, is heavily in use at Novartis. Many other companies are using this. Onyx will talk a little bit about their experience. There is a whole other camp that is using the modified toxicity probability interval, which was proposed by G et al. In 2010. And it's kind of a hybrid method. So G and his companions, colleagues, were at MD Anderson, so this is a method that sort of started over there. And it's a nice method, so it's a compromise between rule-based methods and fully Bayesian methods. This is a Bayesian model at its core, but it's modeling each dose individually. So it's not borrowing information between doses. And because of that, because it's a simpler model, you can actually summarize all the possible decisions after you see a cohort ahead of time. So I won't go into detail of why, but this is actually a design that is used at Merck almost in all their phase 1 oncology trials, and it's used in other companies also. It's very similar in spirit in that, so as I mentioned, there's a model, although here each dose is modeled separately, and so you don't get borrowing of doses. You can model the dose toxicity curve, but it's not actually sort of looking at fitting something to all the doses together. And it does also look at particular intervals of toxicity and base recommendations on whether to escalate, stay, or de-escalate based on those, on being in those intervals. Now, as I mentioned, the difference is that you can ahead of time basically generate a table like this. I don't know if it's very clear, but this is a table you can basically give to the team. So you do a lot of statistical simulations and so on to figure out the properties of your design before the trial starts. But once the trial starts, this is all that the team needs to run the trial. You don't need to run models again. You don't need the statistician again. It's a little bit like the 3+3. You can go off and run the trial. And what this table is telling you is, on the top row, the columns are the number of patients that have been studied at this particular dose, at the current dose. And on the rows are the number of toxicities you've observed. So when I say number of patients treated at current dose, suppose you're at dose, like we saw before, 50, and you've just studied 3 patients. But it might be that 2 cohorts ago, you had studied another 3 patients. So you would actually look in this column at 6 patients, and then based on the number of toxicities that you see, decide whether to escalate, stay, de-escalate. So suppose there were 2 toxicities out of 6, then you would stay, right? And if you then enrolled another 2 patients, so now you're at 8, and you saw 2 more toxicities, then you would land in 4 and 8. I think it's a D, so you de-escalate, right? So then you drop to the next dose. Every time you study a dose, you just use this table, looking at how many patients have been on this dose, treated at this dose, and how many toxicities have you seen. And if you go into this red area, the DU, those are basically de-escalate and don't revisit this dose again. So any dose higher, you basically are considered too toxic. So this is sort of another option that is quite attractive because you do need some upfront statistical input, but once that's done, you can just go ahead, give this to investigators and run with it. Okay, I have a few slides just a bit about protocol development and some of the other things. So protocol development, these things can be worked into the protocol. Obviously, your protocol starts looking a little different. Even though you might be have a lot of flexibility, you basically start with an initial plan and then allow yourself to modify it. So you predefine a provisional dose escalation step. You put in the rules, how you think you might skip doses or not skip doses or introduce doses. You typically sort of specify what your minimum cohort size will be and how large it can get. A predefined DLT criteria, predefine what makes an evaluable patient, and then explore different scenarios, do different simulations to figure out, to make sure that you understand how your design will behave based on how the trial actually runs. The other piece that you need to sort of specify is when does the trial stop? Obviously, it stops if you run out of patients. You might say, I'm using 36 patients for this trial. But you might also stop it early because you're pretty confident you've reached the MTD. And so then you need to sort of specify what are the criteria for stopping early, which might be a minimum number of subjects studied at that dose, a high probability that this is the actual MTD, and whatever other criteria. So these are many things that can change, are design specific, drug specific, but get put into the protocol. Interestingly enough, in terms of the Bayesian logistic regression model, Novartis published in New England Journal of Medicine earlier this year, I think in March, about their saritinib study trial. And if you go to online, because it's a huge appendix, it's like 70 megabytes, but they actually have their whole protocol and statistical analysis plan as an appendix and you can see what language they use, how they present things, how they describe things. So that's really useful, and I encourage you to have a look at that. During the study conduct, basically communication is important. You have to work as a team. You give regular updates, and the data gets cleaned on an ongoing basis. Move along a little bit, but you know, the important thing is there are dose escalation TCs or meetings, and at these meetings, all the information sort of gets brought together. The statistician will sort of use whatever is up-to-date data to provide a recommendation based on the model, and then the team sort of discusses what the recommendation will be based on all the relevant data. This then will get communicated, and the rest of the trial can go on. So just to a little bit of a touch upon a little bit on health authorities, this is based on a slide by somebody from Novartis, but they've had a lot of discussions with the regulatory authorities. All have been positive. The FDA, the EMA are generally positive about these methods as long as patient safety can be ensured. And many of these designs, let's say these newer generations of these designs, are actually very good and ethical for patients. They tend to put more patients on the right doses and get more information out of the trial. Okay. And there are some some opinions from these different groups about this. So, this is a bit of a key message is that, of course, patient safety is always paramount, but these designs are efficient and flexible, and I think they've matured. There's a lot more experience with them at this point, and they can really, really enrich the information that you get out of your trial. It's basically maximizing the information that can be captured out of the data that you collect, and with that, guide decision making. So make better predictions, make better decisions for patients, for your trial, for your